you'll stand, turn to page 305. 305. Praise Him. Praise Him. Is that not why we are here this morning? Amen. To lift up praise to our Father in heaven. Let's do that together. Praise Him. Praise Him. Jesus, our blessed Redeemer. Sing, O earth, His wonderful love proclaim. Hail Him. Hail Him. Highest archangels in glory. Strength and honor give to His holy name. Like a shepherd, Jesus will guard His children. In His arms He carries them all day long. Praise Him, praise Him. Tell of His excellent greatness. Praise Him, praise Him. Ever in joyful song. Praise Him. Jesus, our blessed Redeemer, for our sins He suffered and bled and died. He, our rock, our hope of eternal salvation. Hail Him, hail Him, Jesus the crucified. Sound His praises, Jesus who bore our sorrows. Love unbounded, wonderful, deep, and strong. Praise Him, praise Him. Tell of His excellent greatness. Praise Him, praise Him. Ever in joyful song. On that last, praise Him, praise Him. Jesus, our blessed Redeemer. Heavenly portals loud with Hosanna ring. Jesus, Savior, reigneth forever and ever. Crown Him prophet and priest and king. Christ is coming over the world victorious. Power and glory unto the Lord belong. Praise Him, praise Him. Tell of His excellent greatness. Praise Him, praise Him. Ever in joyful song. Amen. Thank you for that singing. I'm going to tell you what, that's what we're going to do this morning, is just praise God. Amen. I don't want to try to give too much away from what's going to happen this morning, but a lot of praise is going to happen this morning. Amen. And so God is good, is He not? Amen. He is so good. And so I'm glad that you are all here. I'm glad that you are going to be part of our service today. Do not get used to this. Who was it, Caleb? Caleb's like, you look like an awesome youth pastor. Like, well, okay, I guess I'll take that. That's a kind of a compliment, maybe. I don't know, but I told everybody we're going to wear our camp shirts to church this morning, and as it's our youth service. And so I put mine on, and I'm like, man, let me put my suit jacket on. And I still feel, I just don't have my tie. It feels weird. So who was it that told me I should just, Eliza, was that you? You should just wear a tie over top of your T-shirt. Like, that would look even worse. And so we're not going progressive, so don't worry. Don't get used to it. Amen. but I am glad that you are here. Amen. We're going to have a good time this morning. And if you're not ready to have a good time, then have a bad time while we have a good time. I don't know what to tell you. Amen. And so we're going to have fun this morning. I'm excited about it. But let's go to the Lord in prayer this morning. Father, we are so, so grateful for all that You do for us. We're so grateful for, Lord, working in our lives and speaking to us, Lord, and helping us. Lord, we thank You for the week of youth camp that we were able to have, and the safety and the protection, Lord, and then, of course, working in our lives and speaking to us and these teenagers. And Lord, so now I pray that you'll meet with us in a great, great way this morning. Lord, I pray that You encourage these teenagers, Lord, as they share, Lord, and help them, give them courage, Father. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. All right, stay standing and turn to page 341. 341, victory in Jesus. Who here likes to win? Come on now. Yeah? All right, let's sing about it. I heard an old, old story, how a Savior came from glory. gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his groaning, of his precious blood's atoning. Then I repented of my sin and won the victor. Sing it out now. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. He looked me ere I knew him, and all my love was due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I'm going to stop you right there. Amen. He was like at youth camp with us, right? That's what, amen. So almost all those songs, at least, you know, they have those little inserts that you can throw into them. Of course, at youth camp, you have to do that, right? Amen. And so since it is our youth service, let's throw those in there. If you know where it's at, right? Right after bought me, we say sold, right? And then where's the other one? Loved me ere I knew him. And then we say praise God, all right? So you sing that out loud as we sing that second verse together. I heard about his healing, of his cleansing power revealing, how he made the lame to walk again and caused the blind to see. Come and heal my broken spirit. To me the victory, oh victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about a mansion he has built for me in glory, and I heard about the streets of gold beyond the crystal sea, about the angels singing and the old redemption story. And some sweet day I'll sing up there the song of victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. Bought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. Amen. You may be seated. Amen. Thank you for that. Amen. Well, what a great day, amen. What a great week. Had a fantastic week at camp, of course, and a safe drive over and a safe drive back. And we got to stop, actually, on the way, we did stop there on the way there, but on the way home, there in Fossil, and I don't know how many know Brother Wade Bassonet. Amen, Brother Wade Bassonet, and he has been here before, and some of our fellow, he's the one in the wheelchair, right? And so we stopped there, and him and his wife own the Brenda's Blessings. It's a bakery, coffee shop right there on Main Street. And so we stopped there and got pizzas for all the kids, and got to visit with Wade, and so that was a good time. And so we had a great time at camp, amen? And we're going to talk a lot more about that, of course, as we go through the service today. These kids are going to come up and share their camp experience with everybody, amen, and share what the Lord has done in their lives and how God has spoke to them, and just to help be an encouragement to you guys. And so looking forward to that this morning. We also have a video that we are going to show, and kind of just a little way to take you to camp with us, all right? It's not going to be anywhere close to what it was like at camp. But we can kind of share camp with you a little bit. And so it's about a 17-minute long video that we have. In the video, there are, the camp does a camp choir every year. And so all the kids and a bunch of the camp workers youth pastors and pastors' wives and anybody goes together and does this youth choir, and they practice all week long. And then they have, at the end, Friday night, at our last service, they sing those songs that they have prepared. And I'm telling you what, I have never heard a camp choir full of just random kids and adults just thrown together in one week sound more amazing than that youth choir that they put together. And it's that way every year. It's incredible. And so Pastor Knuff is the song director, and he puts together that choir, and he is amazing. And so I have all three of the songs throughout this video, and so we're going to play those for you and let you hear the choir songs. I will say this. Let's see here. I had one, two, four of our kids, we're part of the choir. I'm not going to tell you where they are. You'll have to see if you can find them and who it is as you watch the video, okay? And so I'll be excited about that, all right? So first, let's go through some announcements this morning, birthdays and anniversaries. I'm telling you what, how many more days do we have left of July? Just a few, right? Like a week, right? Is that all we have left? And so soak it in, you birthday people, right? Eliza and Jason, right? Soak in your birthday month. And so we want to wish them a happy birthday this month. Continue to pray for them. And we're excited about that. Okay, next slide. Wednesday Bible study. Of course, I'm back home, but we're not going to have Bible study here, right? So, and you'll see why. We're going to talk about it here in just a second. So Bible study will not be here at the church at 6 o'clock, okay? And you'll see why in just a second. So next slide. Because of this. Amen. So we have our Cowboy Revival at the fairgrounds, okay? And that starts tomorrow. Can you believe that? I can't believe that. I don't feel ready. I've been gone all week. I've been scrambling like crazy the week before to try to finalize things, and I still don't feel all the way completely ready for it. And so, but that starts tomorrow. Pastor McElroy will be coming into town tomorrow afternoon, and then we'll be getting stuff set up at the fairgrounds. And so that will start at 7. I've asked all those that want to help, right? Those workers that are going to help with that, please be there at 6 o'clock tomorrow, okay? 6 o'clock, that way we can get some tables set up, which will probably already be down there, but just kind of arranged, and we'll have everything ready for when people start coming in. I have zero idea how many people are going to be here, okay? We've spread it all over town. We've put up posters and sent out flyers. It's been on the chamber calendar for the chamber. It's been all over the place. And so I have absolutely no idea how many are coming. And so I'm excited to see how many will be there. And so it's going to be a good time. But that'll be tomorrow at 7 o'clock, unless you're one of the workers. And then please be there at 6 o'clock. All right? Please do that if you can. We do have our church shirts here. Amen. Ironically, they're almost the same exact color. Let's see here. Let's get that's a small one. There's a large. Oh, just do this one. they're almost the same color as these shirts. Like, how ironic is that, all right? We didn't even know what color the shirts were going to be for camp, but that's what the back looks like. So there's the back. And then, of course, the front has our church name and logo on the front of them, okay? And so those are our shirts for our event, right? You, after service, so Miss Erin has the list of all the sizes that everybody ordered, okay? And so I'm sorry to say this is only for those that ordered shirts, right? I would like to get a whole bunch that we can just keep here, and then if you want a shirt, you can buy one. And so we may eventually do that. But for right now, we just have enough for those that ordered shirts, okay? And so if you ordered a shirt, you need to come see Miss Erin right after service to get your shirt. And they are $12.50, okay? $12.50 for a shirt. And so, like I said, don't forget, don't run away right after service. Go see Miss Erin. We will get your shirt to you. And then those will be to wear for the event Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday, all right? So, you know, I guess if after each day, you probably have to throw that thing in the wash, right? Throw that thing in the wash in the morning, and then that way you can wear it at night, because I guarantee we'll probably get those things sweaty and dirty. But if you could wear those, that way we can kind of stand out as the church, amen, and do that, all right? I'm excited for this event. Continue to tell as many as you can, amen? Tell as many as you can. I know we have one more day, but we can continue to tell everybody throughout the event, okay? Invite them to come and be a part of that. Like I said, we're giving away fishing gear on Monday night, right, for those that come and fill out a registration card. We'll get put in for fishing gear, tackle box, fishing pole, that kind of thing, right? And then the next night, we're giving away a ukulele. All right. So if you came night one, there's one entry. You came night one and night two, there's two entries for the ukulele. If you come the third night, we are giving away a guitar. All right. And so the guitar, if you come the first night, the second night, and the third night, there's three entries that you could win that guitar, unless you've won one of the other ones previously, okay? And I'll explain this all tomorrow evening at the event, but that way you can tell people, okay? And so they have chances. If they come all three nights, they've got three chances to win that guitar. And I believe, I've not talked to them yet, but I believe Pastor McElroy also brought a guitar for those that bring the most visitors, all right? And so we may be giving away another guitar the last night, Wednesday night, all right? And so if you want a guitar or a ukulele or a fishing pole, you come, right? And you might have a chance to win those and then spread the word on that. And that's all free. Remember, as we tell people, the event is free as well. There is zero charge for this, all right? It is free, 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 free. Who likes free? If you don't like free, I don't know what's wrong with you, right? Free is amazing, right? And so completely free event, okay? All right, that's enough on the Cowboy Revival. Oh, I could keep going on the Cowboy Revival. That's all we have. Those are the only announcements. All right, so let's go for another hour on the Cowboy Revival, amen? Let's talk about it for a while, amen? If you have questions about that, please, after service, come see me, and I'll tell you I don't know. How's that sound? All right, we'll try to give you information as we can. And so I'm excited about it. Be in prayer for it. And then, you know, drag as many people as you can down there to the fairgrounds tomorrow evening. Amen. And we'll have a great, great time. I did talk to Pastor Skip, and they just finished their event yesterday. And so Pastor McElroy was actually preaching for him this morning at their church. And but he said their event went really, really well, and was excited about it. And so they'll be coming down tomorrow. Pastor Skip is also coming tomorrow, so he's going to be here to help out with that. And so many of you know my best friend, Pastor Skip, right? And so we're just buddies, and that guy's a nut, and I'm excited to have him here, and we're going to put him up in his office. A couple people got that. Yeah, a few of you. Yeah, if some of you don't know, we have an upstairs in this church. Anybody know that? There's an upstairs in this church. It's scary up there. Yeah, there's a lot of unfound treasure. Well, I shouldn't say that. There's a lot of skip-found treasures up in the upstairs, because every time he comes here, he loves to go up there and rummage through all of the years of stuff that has accumulated upstairs, and so that's his office. And so every time he comes here, I was like, hey, there's your office. Get upstairs, right? And so anyways, yeah, he'll be here, and we're excited about that. Amen. Okay, I think that's right. That's it for announcements. Was there something else I was supposed to announce? The shirts. I announced that. There's food in the fellowship hall. Those snacks and cakes and all that stuff. If you didn't get any of that during Sunday school, after service, go eat that, because it's going to go bye-bye. Okay? So you need to go see what's in there and get those snacks and good food in the fellowship hall. Okay? Is that everything? Once, twice, I think so. I hope so. All right, Caleb, Colton, come on up here and let's take up an offering this morning. Amen. All right. Man, that was quick. Whoa, I don't even have time to ramble. I kind of like this front row thing. I think we might have to just stick with it from now on, right? Yeah, sounds good. Okay. That was the thing at camp, is everybody would fight for the front row at camp. And so then they had to make seating arrangements, so everybody got a chance to sit on the front row. I've never seen so many kids fight for the front row. It's unbelievable, right? And so it was fun, man. I had a good time. All right, let's pray for the offering this morning. Lord, we are just so grateful for what you give to us, Lord, and how you provide for us. I pray now that you'll help us, Lord, as we give back to you, Lord, and I pray that you'll help us to give with joyful hearts, Lord, and just to be able to use this offering to further your word and your work here in this place, Lord. I pray you'll bless the gift and the giver. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. And one more time, turn to page 145. I love to tell the story. I love to tell the story. On that first, I love to tell the story of unseen things above, of Jesus and his glory, of Jesus and his love. I love to tell the story because I know 'tis true. It satisfies my longing as nothing else can do. I love to tell the story. 'Twill be my theme in glory to tell the old story of Jesus and his love. Let's go to that fourth verse. I love to tell the story for those who know it best, seems hungering and thirsting to hear it like the rest. the story. 'Twill be my theme in glory to tell the other story of Jesus and his love. Amen. You may be seated this morning. Thank you for that singing. I really appreciate it. All right, let Miss Erin get down. Put her shoe back on. I know, we've got to have those tall shoes on and can't play a piano. I said, I don't know if I like her wearing those because she's like 7 feet tall. Make me feel like a little child when I stand next to her. So no pictures of me and my wife today. Not doing it. Trying. All right, so we're going to play a video. Is it already, hey man, look at you on top of things, man. You're definitely hired. That's okay. I don't care about the back screen. As long as the front two screens will show that. And so I put this together. These are just some pictures and a few videos and, of course, the choir songs from youth camp. And so I would have liked to have done a whole lot more, but the video probably would have been like an hour long. So I tried to keep it as short as possible and get into there what we were able to do here at youth camp. And so how many churches were represented at youth camp? Do you remember? I'm trying to think. Oof. I bet there was probably at least 10 churches. At least 10 churches represented there. There was almost 300 people at camp this year. That's, you know, workers and teenagers and everybody. And so it was packed out. Amen. And you'll see in some of the videos, I've got some of our one congregational song that we were all singing, and it shows the whole auditorium in there, just packed full of young people. And it was amazing. The preaching was amazing. The two preachers some of the kids are going to talk about them a little bit. And now that I'm up here talking, I'll probably forget all of their names. But Pastor Gaddis was the main preacher, and he's a pastor at Heartland Baptist Bible College. He's the pastor for their church down there. And so he came up and preached for us, did an amazing job. And then a pastor named Pastor Pyle, he's in Nampa, Idaho. We'll be seeing more of Pastor Pyle. Amen. And so he may be actually preaching for us next year at our fellowship meeting that we have in October. I've already spoken to him about that. He's going to try to be here this October for our meeting, but took a liking to Pastor Pyle. He's doing a great job there, and so he's did a wonderful job as he preached. And I'm telling you what, I don't think anybody at camp left there without the Lord speaking to them. If they did, they put earplugs in. And they just ignored God. It was awesome. It was a great time. And so, all right, with that said, we're going to play this video for you guys. And so hopefully you enjoy it.
Help but think about the Lord. until I die, there'll still be many more. If I could mention only one, I'd like to thank him for his son, and that's enough to praise the Lord for all he's done.
Death, and now I'm free. How worthy is he? How wonderful, powerful is our God? How loving, forgiving is the Son? How worthy is he? How come and we'll finally see. Every wonder will be revealed. I'm so restless to see my King. How worthy is he? How wonderful, powerful is our God?
every wonder you reveal. I'm so restless to see my King. How worthy is He? How our God, how loving, forgiving is the Son. How worthy is He.
O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds Thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, Thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to Thee. How great Thou
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Wasn't that good? Oh my goodness. So you could, I know it was kind of far away to see who was in the choir. I'll let them tell you when they come up here that they got to sing in the choir. Those choir songs are amazing. I know it doesn't translate very good over video compared to what it was live. And I know I wish I could take our whole church with us to go to youth camp. Amen. I really do. It's an amazing time. I want to say thank you to all of you that took part in helping allow our kids to go. That was huge. You parents allowing your kids to go, I just say thank you to allowing them to go with us. We had a fantastic time. And I know we are a small group, but I will say this. I've talked to a lot of churches, but we're the only group that got to take our kids, and they didn't pay a dime. And they didn't pay a thing to go to camp. It was kind of funny. They do a game show, camp game show, over a portion of, like, Galatians, and it was kind of a challenge. And the winner of the game show got free camp for next year. And so I was telling Pastor Matt, who's the director of the camp, I was like, well, that's not very much incentive for our kids because they all got to come to camp for free. And so, that's because of you guys and because of you being willing to help support our kids. Yes, the community and the car wash and things like that. We have an amazing community. And so I'm so thankful for that as well. So at this time, I'm going to have everybody that went to camp come up. You guys were dreading this moment, right? You're like, just keep rambling, preacher, keep rambling. So I want everybody to come up, and I'm going to y'all just line up right here. Line up right here. Did you get this mic turned up? We'll make Taylor go first since he's back there. Come on. We're all waiting on you. Slow poke. The one time I would have been okay for you to run in church, and you wasted it. Go over there. All right, so they all have their camp books. All of them have their camp books. And so they handed these out at camp, and in that, there's a few things. So there's places they can take notes as for the different sermons and different things. We had how many sermon? Three each day. So we had like a morning Bible session in the morning at 8:30. Listen, if your kids say they can't get up early, they can, okay, they can. We had our morning session at 8:30, and then we have a time that's called God and I time, and it's a portion, it takes Psalms, and we start at Psalms 1, and you just read through that Psalm, and then there's four questions that they can answer in their booklet about that portion of Scripture, and we did that every day. And we're, as a youth group, we're going to continue that. We're through the whole year, we're going to go through Psalms twice. And so we're going to do that as a youth group. So they got to fill those out. But there's also a place in here that's at the very end. It's called Letters to Me. And so last year we did that, and I saved those, and so I was able to show the kids that were there last year what their letter was to themselves from the year before. And so they did it again this year. And so I've asked them to share with you guys some things that the Lord spoke to them about. Most of them are probably going to read their letters that they wrote to themselves. So if they seem past tense, that's on purpose, because it's to them next year, right? And so some of them are reading that. Some of them are added extra, have some different things that the Lord did for them this week. And so let's encourage them as they share. I told them not to preach, right, Eliza? No preaching. Okay, all right. All right, Colton, no rambling. Yeah, got to stay. That's why they have their notebook, so they can read it, right, and not ramble. Yes, okay, all right. Just like, I'll give you three big red comments.
Big red comments.
Three. You only get three.
Gotcha.
Okay, so don't waste them. Okay, all right. Are you ready?
Yeah.
All right.
So I'm going to start with what God convicted me at camp this week, and some decisions that I made was to surrender my life to God for his leading and to do whatever he asked me to do. And on Friday, we were doing a question and answer time, and one of the preachers, his name is Brother Pyle, he was answering a question and said that he had hidden something from his parents for like 5 years, and when he finally told them, that it was like a burden lifted off his shoulder. And God was convicting me ever since last year at camp, and I had been keeping something from my parents for that long. And after he said that, God was telling me that I need to tell them. So that was convicting me, and I finally told them what I was hiding from them, and it was like a huge burden lifted off of me. And the funnest thing that I think was at camp was, part of it was the preaching, and it was also everyone participating in the games and how fun that was. And we also competed in the basketball tournament that we had, and we were the smallest team there, like everyone else was 6 foot and up. And we placed third in that tournament out of five teams. And our team was me, Baron, George, Caleb, and Colton. And I think we did pretty good.
I'm gonna start off by saying my decisions that I made at camp last week. The decisions that I made at camp last week, the preaching was amazing, and Brother Pyle and Brother Gaddis were just speaking in my heart. And so I went up to the altar, and Jesse Gosnell came and prayed with me, and I prayed that God will help me read my Bible every day and not be lazy. And he just spoke in my heart that week, and it was a great blessing for me. And one thing that stood out to me was Brother Gaddis. He was a great preacher. He said that obeying your parents is the best thing that you could ever do for God. And God spoke to me for that. So my job for him is that I'm going to obey my parents whatever way they want me to do, and I will not get frustrated with them and just do it. But yeah, and I had two favorite parts about camp. The preaching was great. Brother Pyle, he was a great preacher. I hope we can see him again. Brother Gaddis, he spoke into everybody's hearts that whole entire week. I also loved the water slide. That was pretty fun. And that basketball tournament, man, that was crazy. One of my favorite parts about that basketball camp was Colton scored on the 6 foot guy. That was crazy.
He was like 6'6".
6 foot six. That was pretty fun. But yeah, I just had a great week at camp, and thank you guys for helping us raise the money that we needed.
Well, I'd like to start off by thanking y'all for supporting us and bringing us to camp, because we couldn't have done it without you. I'll say my decision I made at camp, I decided to not have a split heart anymore. I've been putting other things before church and before God, and I'm done doing that. So, the basketball tournament was fun, I guess. I don't know. Yeah, that's about all.
All right, well, I'm going to have y'all turn to Revelation chapter 30. There's no Revelation chapter 30. No, but I'm going to talk about my decisions I made for the Lord. I decided to dedicate my life to God and do what he wants me to do, and go where he wants me to go. I'll read my letter to me. It says, "Hello, future me. You are probably cool. But anyways, stay humble to God and do what he says and go where he leads. Don't ignore his calling. Just be a servant to him. Witness to people and tell them about him. Don't be scared to show your faith. Trust in God. Have faith in him, and he will be, and you will be good to go. Bro, you're probably going to be a teen now, so don't do stupid teen stuff, even though being a teen's pretty cool. All right, that's it. Peace." And then my favorite part of camp was probably the last night, because our team got the win, and so we got to stay and have snacks and watch a movie, and it was a bunch of fun. So that was it. All right.
All right. I'm just going to read my letter. "Dear future me, I hope you got good grades so your parents aren't mad at you. Remember, last year you made a commitment to do what God wants you to do. If you aren't still devoted to God, I'll be mad. I learned that truth is freedom in one way, reading the Bible. I would just like to remind you that following God and missing out on worldly things is better than going to hell. God spoke to me through Pastor Gaddis that I need to be considerate about who I hang out with at school. And my favorite part about camp was the preaching."
Okay, I really enjoyed camp this year. First of all, I'd really like to thank you guys for supporting us. Like, every single last penny was worth it. It was amazing. Camp was a blast. It was so much fun. Thank you guys for supporting us. And some decisions I made at camp this year was to fully surrender myself to God. I think it was Brother Gaddis that was speaking, and he said that true happiness comes with full surrender in life. And so I discovered that. And I felt conviction in my heart from God to just go to the altar and pray about it. And I did. And I felt a huge burden lifted off of me. And I just feel happy. I like it. And one of my favorite parts about camp was going on the water slide. That thing was huge. And you went really fast down it. And the food was good. Yes, it was. I just had to do that to annoy Pastor. I had to do that to annoy him. And let's see here. I'm just rambling at this point. I won't, due to lack of time. And once again, I'd like to thank you guys for supporting us. Thank you.
I would first like to thank you all for letting us go and supporting us in that. It was best week of my life by far. I made the decision to get saved through this week, and it was greatest decision ever. One of the pastors, while they were preaching, said, "God has a future for those who have a past." And I also, earlier that day, I had found that quote in my study Bible, and I just felt that so much. So then that night, I went and found Miss Erin, asked her to pray with me, and got saved. And that was just the best decision ever. And so that was my favorite thing about camp. The preaching was just amazing, so convicting, so powerful. It was best. It was so cool. So thank you guys for supporting us in that.
Amen. Eliza also really liked our cabin mates. So Eliza is 100% country girl. and we were three country girls in a cabin full of 11 city-fied girls. So there was pounds of makeup and trying on lots of clothes at midnight and leaving the lights on while we were trying to sleep. So that was Eliza's most favorite part of camp. Well, I'm gonna try not to cry because I could probably talk for hours and hours and hours about how amazing camp was and what God did for me personally. You know, I have gone to camp since I was 13. Camp is where I surrendered my life to the Lord. Camp has always been very important in my life, and even as an adult, I was also called a mom this week. Like, she's just a mom. So I've arrived at no longer being, you know, the young one. The kids were annoyed at me. But anyways, not my kids, the city-fied girls. But even for Pastor and I, camp was so powerful and convicting and encouraging to spend a whole week with these kids. If you ever have a desire to go spend an entire week with teenagers, you should do it. Drop everything and run and go to camp because it is amazing and will change your life. I wanted to read a portion of scripture that really spoke out to me this week. The theme from our shirts says truth is freedom, and that was out of John chapter 8, verse 31 and 32. I have no idea who preached this message that spoke on this verse, but it spoke to me, and it's in Deuteronomy chapter 7, verse 6. That says, for thou art an holy people unto the Lord thy God. The Lord thy God hath chosen thee to be a special people unto himself above all people that are upon the face of the earth. And, you know, I could talk about a lot of stuff that God convicted me on, things in my life that need to change, ways that, you know, I have dropped my convictions and let worldly things creep into my home and just gotten slack. But the truth of the matter is God has called us, his children, to be a holy people set apart for him. And we are special. And that's like the whole gist of truth is freedom. And the convictions and the life-changing things all wrap around to we are supposed to be different. We are supposed to be, the world is supposed to look at us and see that we are different. And unfortunately, a lot in my life wasn't showing that. A lot in my life was mimicking the world. And I think it's easy sometimes to get comfortable in our Christian walk, comfortable in wanting to be liked, in wanting to have friends, in wanting to have people that we just kind of let things slide. But seeing these kids make decisions, seeing Eliza get saved, seeing their desire to serve the Lord, was like a fire within me to want to, like, I don't know, one of you said, I don't remember, someone said something about serving the Lord and, oh, not having a divided heart and kind of playing both sides of the field. I have been guilty of that. And so that all the messages, the preaching, there was a message from Brother Addison Smith about the dangers of social media. And that was convicting. Literally every message of every day was convicting and just drew me to want to be that special set apart for God, no matter what, no matter what the world says, no matter if I'm liked or not liked. I just want to serve God. That's all. And so thank you again for supporting us, for sending our kids, for loving our kids. I'll speak for Cheyenne. Her favorite part was not the water slide. She went down the water slide like a trooper and landed in the water and came up crying. She was not having it. But I think she had fun getting to hang out with all the kids. So thank you again for sending us.
job. Good job. Again, thank you. Now I'm going to preach an hour-long message, so hang on. You're all like, what? Amen. I am going to give a charge this morning to you as a church, though. And so as I ramble for a minute, you can turn to 1 Samuel. 1 Samuel chapter 17, we're going to look here, but I do want to say this, that this week at camp, yes, was amazing to watch these young teenagers make decisions for God. Amen. It was exciting to watch these young teenagers come forward in a room full of kids. And decide to come forward to an altar and then to make some pretty important decisions in their lives and some pretty hard, tough decisions that they made. And I told them during Sunday school class, there's a lot of adult Christians that won't do what you did. There's a lot of adult Christians that have been saved for a lot of years that have never fully surrendered their life or have never really given over to God what he's asking or never even really walked down an aisle to come and kneel at an altar, and these kids did it with 300 people in a room. That takes some courage. And so it was exciting for me to be able to watch these kids work, and not just in these in our kids, but in all the kids. I did not get a number, but there was probably two hands, but maybe both feet of kids that got saved this week at youth camp, and many others that have made decisions to serve God. And so it was very, very exciting, and I'm already looking forward to next year. Amen. I'm already looking forward to what God is going to do in these young people's lives. So I want to just bring a challenge. I'm not going to say a message, so I'll spare you, right? It's a 25-point challenge. Y'all don't know whether I'm joking or if I'm telling the truth. I can see it on your face. This is like a hesitant laugh. Like, really? I'm going to... Pastor Pyle preached Friday evening the last message to everybody. And throughout the week, he preached a series on voices. In the voices that we hear as people and as Christians, there's lots of voices out there, is there not? I mean, there's positive voices and there's negative voices that we all hear. And then there's also our own voice. And so his last message was on ignoring three types of voices that are in our lives, and we're going to kind of look at these. But as we go through this, I want to challenge you as a church with these kids to be a voice. And we're going to look at what kind of voice. And so I'm going to try to go really, really fast. I know it's already afternoon, and we have already heard some great things. But I really feel that the Lord's in this to challenge you as a church, not only to help these kids, but to help with your walk as well. And so here, as we are in chapter 17 of 1 Samuel here, I'm going to try to skim through this as fast as we can. I know that we went over the life of David before as a church. It's been a while now since we've gone through the life of David, and we've preached through this, but there's so many good truths here, all right? And so let's go to verse 12 of chapter 17. It says, now David was the son of that Ephrathite of Bethlehem, Judah, whose name was Jesse, and he had eight sons. How many here would like to have eight sons? So you would like to have eight. You would like to have eight sons? Oh my goodness, Kelly Lou. Amen. Yeah. Had eight sons, and the man went among men far for an old man in the days of Saul. And the three eldest sons of Jesse went and followed Saul to battle. Okay, and then let's skip down to verse 14 and says, and David was the, what does that say? Youngest. And we all probably knew that already about David. David was the youngest. and the three eldest followed Saul. Now, Saul, remember, being king of Israel at that time, and Jesse's three oldest boys were soldiers in the army of Israel, and they followed Saul, all right? And so Jesse's three oldest were probably like, you know, what we would call generals or lieutenants in the army there. They were high up in Saul's military. All right. Verse 16 says, and the Philistine drew near morning and evening and presented himself 40 days. Of course, we all understand who this Philistine is, right? Goliath. All right. This Philistine is Goliath. Okay. Verse 17, and Jesse said unto David, his son, take now for thee, for thy brethren an ephah of this parched corn and these 10 loaves, and run, if you want to, circle that, underline that, mark that, okay? It did not say on your own leisure. It did not say walk. It did not say, just a stroll along and eventually, what does it say? Run. How many here like to run? Anybody? Just my favorite thing to do is run. I know that's RC's favorite thing to do, right? You just love to, right? No. Blech. Okay? Blech. Blech. Maybe one time we would like to run, right? But he says, and run to the camp to thy brethren. And carry these 10 cheeses unto the captain of their thousands, and look how the brethren fare, and take their pledge. Now verse 20. And David rose up early in the morning, not at noon, because he stayed up so late the night before, right? And just, this bed is so comfy, right? No. But he said what? Right, rose up early in the morning and left the sheep with the keeper and took and went. And Jesse, as Jesse had commanded him, who was it that said they'd obey their parents? There you are. Oh. What is David doing here? Obeying, amen, obeying, as Jesse had commanded him, and he came to the trench as the host was going forth to fight and shouted for the battle. For Israel and the Philistines had put the battle in array, army against army, and David left his carriage in the hand of the keeper and the carriage and ran, what was he doing again? Obeying, and ran into the army and came and saluted his brethren. All right, and so for sake of time, David comes into the camp where they are all at, all right, and this Philistine named Goliath every day would come down into the valley there, and he would challenge the Israelite army. He would curse their God, and he would curse them, and he would challenge them to come and fight him. And if you don't know about Goliath, Goliath was a very, very large man, even in today's standards, right? Very large man, anywhere between 9 and 10 foot tall. Very big man. And so he would go down and challenge the army of Israel. And every time Goliath would come down and scream and yell at them, the army, these soldiers, these trained soldiers that knew how to fight, that have fought wars before and have been in plenty of battles and have had numerous victories over their enemies, all right? These aren't just men that got drafted and had no idea what they're talking about. These are men that knew how to fight. This Israelite army. And Goliath would come out, and what would they do? They would go hide in their tents. They would go hide and cower because they were scared of this man called Goliath. They did not want to go face him, all right? The worst part was even their own king was hiding, right? Saul was even hiding in his tent, right? And so now that's the picture that we find as David now excited to see how his brothers are doing, excited to see how the army, if you will, of God is doing against this godless nation, this godless group of men, the Philistines, that hated God, hated anything to do with God, would do everything to oppose God, right? And so David comes running in, salutes his brothers, and is excited to see and get report on how things are going. And as he shows up, he witnesses, if you will, all of his heroes, all of these men that he looked up to cowering in their tents. As this one Goliath stands and curses his God. Now David, of course we understand, is just a young teenager, probably the age of some of these here. David is not a soldier, but he is a man of God. David does not have a sword and a shield. He does not have military training, but he has a love for God. Now listen, stay with me now. David, at that time in his life, the ministry that God gave David was to obey his father. And David was also in charge of his father's sheep. He took care of his sheep. Now, the sheep that David took care of was probably in the hundreds, if not thousands. Lots of sheep. It was a great responsibility. We understand the story of David that protected those sheep against a bear and a lion. But that was David's job. Easy to look down on somebody that's just a shepherd. Now, I want us to focus here as we look at three voices that David heard. As he heard, now one, yes, the Philistine cursing God, right? And as that happened, David says, why is nobody stepping up to him? Why is there nobody accepting this challenge? Why is nobody here willing to go and fight this man that is obviously against God? Why is no, he is cursing our God, he is blaspheming our God, that cannot happen. Why is there nobody? David comes to the point where he says what? Is there not a cause? Is there not a cause to go against this Philistine? So we come down to verse 28. Verse 28, and Eliab, his eldest, David's eldest brother, heard when he spake unto the men. And Eliab's anger was kindled, that means that was ignited or enraged against David. And he said, why comest thou down hither? What are you doing here? And with whom hast thou left those, what does he say here? Few sheep in the wilderness. I know thy pride and thy naughtiness of thine heart, for thou art come down that thou mightest see the battle, okay? And so here now, the first voice that David hears, right? David is there doing his father's work. David is there to be obedient. This is coming off. Do you want to turn that on? Taylor, turn that air conditioner on, please. Who else is hot? Anybody else hot? Boy, I'm getting worked up. Amen. It's the first time I think I've preached in a t-shirt. This is great. David comes to this scene now, being obedient to his father, right? Obeying the command that his father gave to him. Hey, go and support your brothers. Go and feed them. Go give them what they need so that they can be successful in their battle. And then give a report. Find out what's going on, right? So David shows up and he's so excited, if you will. David has some zeal for the work of his father. Are you with me? David is excited. How do I know that? Because Jesse told David to run, and David did what? He ran. Now, young kids love to run, right? Everywhere these little guys go, they do what? They run. I don't think there's walk in them, right? Hey, go do that. They're just running. But as they get older, something happens. They turn into this. Right? And you tell them to go do something, especially if it's something that they're not really interested in. And what do? Maybe it's just my kids' parents, but right? Hey, go clean your room. See if I can set the scene here. I know you guys can't see me over there. Go clean your room, okay? Did you hear me? Yeah. I said go clean your room. I will. Anybody? Yeah? I said go clean your room now, not tomorrow. Okay. Is it just mine? Okay. All right. Seems like 30 minutes later, there's find something else to do, right? Shan gets distracted 15,000 times before she gets to where she's going. Right? Yeah. Okay. Yeah, that's right. If I was to tell them, hey, drop everything, all your chores you're doing right now, stop it right now. Go get some ice cream and go play video games. Oh, yeah. Woo! They'd be all about it, right? Listen now, David was told to go minister to his brothers, right? David was told to go to the battlefront and go get a report from them. And David was had some zeal, had some excitement, and David was being obedient to his father, and he ran to the battlefield. Amen. He was excited, amen? And so as he gets there, he sees the scene. It breaks his heart. He's like, what is going on? Is there not a cause? Why is nobody standing up for this? If nobody else will, then I will. And his oldest brother, hears about this and goes to David and says, David, what is your problem? David, what are you doing here? You don't belong. David, what you do is really unimportant. You're few sheep. That's what he was saying. Hey, where's your few sheep? Hey, remember your piddly job that you have? We're soldiers. You're just a shepherd. Go back to your sheep. You shouldn't be here. Listen, sometimes voices can come from family members. Listen to me. I'm going to try to be quick. I know it's 12:24, but hang with me now. Sometimes these voices can come from family, and they can be a real discouragement. Listen, families of these kids have made some decisions for God this week. These kids have come back from youth camp with some fire and some zeal and some excitement to obey their father. Amen. They've come back and you've heard some of their decisions and they're excited about these decisions, but I'm telling you, some of these decisions are going to be hard to follow through with. Some of these decisions are going to be difficult and they're going to need help and they're going to need, yes, the Lord's help, but listen, they're going to need your help, and those voices of negativity should not come from family. Let's look at the next one. Go down to me to verse 33. David continues on and says now, and Saul said to David, thou art what? Not able to go against this Philistine to fight with him, for thou art but a youth, and he a man of war from his youth. Okay, listen to me. He gets past his brother, who is a jerk. Right? Big jerk head, doesn't think I can do anything, right? Tell me that my job is insignificant, and he's just a big old jerk anyways. I never really liked him. We can get past a brother. But David comes to who now? Come on now, come on, stay with me. The king of Israel, someone that David looks up to. And says, hey, king, can you not hear this guy? If nobody else, if you won't go fight, I will. And the king says what? You're too small. You're too young. You'll probably die. You shouldn't be here. You shouldn't be doing what you're wanting to do. Now listen, lack of time. That can be us as a church. Hear me now. That can be us as a church. We have a bunch of young people in our church that now have a desire to serve God. We have a bunch of young people in our church that have a desire to do what God wants them to do. God has been working in their life and they're excited about it. God has been showing them areas in their life that they can change and they can make better, and they're excited to do that. How many of you have heard teenagers this age say, "Hey, I just want to be obedient to my parents"? How often do you hear that? I'm telling you right now, these kids are excited to do what God wants them to do. And sometimes we as a church, who these kids look up to, who these kids come to church, and they look up to us as adults, they look up to us as leaders in this church, and they say, "Hey, guess what? God has called me to full-time service. God has called me to be a witness in my church. God has told me I'm going to carry my Bible to my church every single, or to my school every day. Hey, I want to pray. I want to do all these things. I want to serve. I want to do a ministry in the church. I want to be obedient to my parents." I don't know, whatever it is that God's working on their lives, and we as adults in the church say, "That's nice. Oh, that's cute. Praise God. How long will that last?" It's easy to make those decisions at camp, but now you're living in reality. I've heard them all. And we as adults say, "You know what? You guys are just too young to make really serious decisions for God right now. You guys are too young to really commit your life to God right now. You should wait till you graduate high school to make those commitments." Listen, we as a church can be a voice of negativity to these young kids. Don't be like Saul. Don't be like the brother. Last one. I'm trying to go so fast. Verse 42. And when the Philistine looked about and saw who? David. He disdained him, for he was but a youth and ruddy and of fair countenance. And the Philistine said unto David, "Am I a dog that thou comest to me with staves?" And the Philistine cursed David by his gods. And the Philistine said to David, "Come to me, and I will give thy flesh unto the fowls of the air and to the beasts of the field." David said, verse 45, "Then David said unto the Philistine, Thou comest to me with a sword, with a spear, with a shield, but I come to thee in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom thou hast defied." Listen to me now, church, right? These young kids, these young teenagers are going, absolutely going to be attacked by the world. These young kids are going to be attacked by those that hate God. These kids are going to be ridiculed. These kids are going to be blasphemed against God. They're God blasphemed against. Listen, these kids are going to hear it from their friends, right? They're going to go and "Hey, I was at youth camp." "Well, what did you do at youth camp?" "Well, I made some decisions." That's dumb. Telling you, they're going to be attacked by the world. There's going to be those voices. Listen, teenagers, I want to challenge you now. Let's be like David. Let's be like David. He went from his brother and said, "You know what? I don't want to listen to you anymore. I'm going to continue on. There's a cause to stand up for God." And he got to the king. And the king said, no, "You're too young, you can't do it." And David says, "You know what, I'm not even going to listen to you because you're not speaking truth right now. I'm going to follow God because there's a cause," right? And he gets now down to Goliath, this giant who is probably just so massive to David. And this giant stands before him with this booming voice and this sword and a spear and this shield. The shield's so big he had to have a shield bearer to carry his shield for him, right? And it was a scary scene that's standing before him. And he's threatening David, not just just saying, hey, you're too young, but not just saying, hey, go home like the others said, but this Goliath, this giant now looking at David saying, hey, you're but a youth to me, you're of no significance to me, and matter of fact, I'm going to stomp you out, I'm just going to kill you, I'm just going to murder you here and now and be done with you. Listen, the world wants to destroy our young people, the world wants to see our kids fail, the world wants to ruin them and snuff them out if they have any sort of desire to serve God. It's going to happen. But kids, let's be a David. And David looked at Goliath and said, you come to me with all these instruments of war and death, and I come to you with God. And we know the end of the story. David threw that stone that sunk in that giant's head, and down to his face he fell, and David ran again. David ran to that giant and used that giant's own sword. Can you see that picture? That would have been hilarious, right? This massive sword. And cut the Goliath's head off. And David held it up and proclaimed his God. Amen. Listen to me. I've challenged these teenagers, yes, to follow God's will for their life. I'm going to challenge you, church. I'm going to challenge you that are here. Listen, if God is moving in your life, be obedient to it. Hey, if God is convicting you in areas in your life, hey, be obedient to it. If God is moving in any way, whether it be you need to get saved, or you need to get baptized, or you need to surrender your life to the Lord, or you need to get rid of some sin in your life and some decisions and things that are going on, maybe you just need to be obedient to God. And don't listen to the negative voices. Church, don't be a negative voice. Be an encouragement to these kids. Be a David. Kids, don't listen to negative voices wherever they come from, but just follow God and be a David. Stand with your heads bowed and your eyes closed this morning. I know the hour's long, and I apologize, but I think it's worth it. Amen. I think it was worth hearing what these kids had to say. I think it was worth listening to the decisions that they made. And it's going to be a different invitation this morning, I know. But listen, I just want to say this, as Miss Erin plays when she gets ready. Listen, if God has spoken to you as an adult, listen, if God has shown you an area in your life that you need to make right, or an area in your life that you need to surrender, you just heard from a bunch of teenagers that were brave enough to obey God. What's wrong with us? Can we be as brave as these kids and make decisions for God? Maybe God this morning has been talking to you about your salvation. We just heard from Eliza that she got saved this week. I'm telling you what, that was amazing. That was amazing. I watched her for days fight that. She fought that because she was scared. And eventually she said, I don't care because it's worth it. And she trusted Christ as her personal Savior. Guess what? She gets an eternity in heaven. The moment she trusted Christ as her Savior, Jesus in heaven started pounding out her mansion. There's some kids here that have been dealing with some things in their lives. Divided hearts, living wishy-washy, sort of serving God and sort of serving self. They gave that up this week. Listen to me. If you're here and God's moving, would you be as brave as a teenager? Would you be as brave as a David and allow God to work? Don't allow those negative voices to come in. Don't be a negative voice. Maybe it's just to come down the altar and say, hey, Lord, help me to be an encouragement to these young people. This is the next generation, church. This is the next generation. It behooves us to help them. It behooves us to instruct them. So if God's worked this morning in your heart and your life, maybe it's just to come praise God. This altar is open. I want you to come. You come as God is leading you. If you need to do business with God, you come. Don't ignore him. Don't turn him away. You be obedient to the leading of the Holy Spirit this morning, and you come.
Thank you for joining us this morning on our live stream services. I hope you enjoyed the service. I just want to take a moment to speak to those of you that may not know if you are saved this morning. I would like to share some verses with you. And if you made that decision about salvation, I would ask that you would please comment on our Facebook page, or you could email us, or even call the church and get in touch with us in any way. I would please ask you to do that. First, I want to just share a few verses speaking about salvation and the importance of it. Romans 3:23 says, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." And that talks about everybody. Every person that is ever born has sin, and because of that sin, we cannot enter into the kingdom of heaven. And Romans 6:23 says, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." And thank God that he sent his son, Jesus Christ, to die on a cross for your sins and for my sins. That way we can have an opportunity to spend eternity with him in heaven. Romans 5:8 says, "But God commendeth his love toward us, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." Romans 10:9-10 says that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. And I'm going to ask you this morning, if you want to trust Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, that's exactly what it takes. A prayer, a confession of sin, asking God to forgive you of your sins and to come into your heart and to save you. I'm going to ask, if you made that decision this morning, once again, please, would you let us know some way that way we can pray for you and get in contact with you and encourage you. If you've been watching and you are saved, I ask that you would just make a decision for your Heavenly Father this morning and continue to serve God. If you're not a member here and are curious about membership, I'd ask that you'd please contact us or come to the church and let us know. If you're curious about baptism, I would ask that you'd also please get in contact with us, and we can answer any questions and help in any way. I hope and trust that this message has been a blessing to you and helped you with where you are. And I hope and trust that you will serve God in these remaining days that we have. May God bless you. Have a good day.